Друзья, на самый острый вопрос жизни, кем я хочу стать, я думаю, мы сегодня не имеем ответа. Мы не знаем, кого готовить, мы не знаем даже, кем мы будем работать через 10 лет. Сегодня мир так быстро меняется, что тысячи и сотни тысяч человек должны менять свою профессию. Цифровизация, автоматизация, применение искусственного интеллекта в ближайшие годы и десятилетия освободят или изменят большую часть профессий, освободят большую часть людей. Чем мы будем заниматься?
And what we are going to do and in the nearest and in the future. By the way, the labor statistics of the United States, that average a person works for 4 years and a half, but the young people they change their work even faster. So there's twice as fast, twice as often. And so then recently saw the president of the savings bank so said that 70% of the personnel so was replaced by AI. So you remember how the stock exchanges worked? As they used to, so when the traders were scurrying around, and so how they were busy. So now the Moscow Stock Exchange does 160,000 transactions every minute, and so this 24 hours is 7 million transactions a day, and so the other chamber just will follow the same path. It's impossible to change, and so then we cannot compete with men. The men cannot compete with the AI. And so the question is just who do we prepare? Who do we train at our institutions or colleges? So we should not teach knowledge, not facts. We should train them skills and competences that will allow to learn during your entire time, that will allow us to change professions, to so quickly learn and use spheres, study nonstop, to become new ones. And so opening new challenges. So I would like just to refer to the quote of Albert Einstein, who said, so when he was asked, so do you remember the speed of sound? What the speed of sound is, I don't remember, just go to the reference book and just look. And so because the value of education, college, of liberal arts is not just to get lots of facts, but how to learn to think, to learn to study. That's exactly what is absent in our textbooks. So that's why I want to talk about liberal college of arts. And so, and I would like to talk about education, which is referred to as liberal arts and science. I would like to talk about this kind of education so that we translate as liberal arts and science. So then what is this model? What does it look like? And I would like just to refer to quote Steve Jobs, who in his presentation was saying, quote, that it's not that technical specialists are not sufficient in DNA of Apple. So we understand that technologies are not sufficient, so they need to be combined with arts and humanities to make our hearts sing. That's exactly what we need. And then he spoke at length. So that's exactly so. Then mathematicians, engineers, he does not need so many of them. So he needs design specialists who learn how to connect the achievements of different sciences, arts in one product, putting it all together, who can establish a new dialogue with men, who can just simplify this kind of work for this education and learning complex mechanisms so that even an old lady could make use of this complicated, complex mechanism. So the dialogue with men is one of the most important areas of liberal arts specialists and students and at our department. That's where I work. And so Microsoft actually pays attention to that as well in its documents. And the main task today is what is a liberal arts model that helps to operate and work in the 21st century. And first and foremost, I would like just to say that our department, which is called the Department of Liberal Arts and Science, St. Petersburg University, sometimes many people start asking questions. So it raises eyebrows. So are you just training liberals? No, that's not what we're doing. Maybe just you are training artists, musicians, architects. Who do you train? who do you teach soda water, or arts people? No, it's not the full question answer, because liberal arts appeared as go back to the ancient Greece. So it's a science. It's a list of science goes back to ancient Greece, and then in medieval Europe, liberal arts. So the artes liberalis in Latin. So actually, it consisted of seven keys. The first one is trivium. Trivium is which is grammar, rhetoric, and dialectics. So any adult, independent, educated, free person should be able to wield these things, to be able just to stand for his position, to argue his position, to stand by his principles, and live in this convoluted society. Then there is two, four more sciences added: quadrum, with arithmetic, geometry, astronomy, and music, which actually became part of the of exact sciences, because it learned harmony, it studied harmony that exists in music. And so all these sciences actually became the essence of the classical education in medieval ages, which actually stayed, survived until the present time, although certainly the number of sciences have grown up. But the liberal arts, those basic sciences, it's not just studying these sciences, but today liberal arts is creating new skills and competences that more often than not we refer to as soft skills, flexible skills, flexible skills. So then the International Economic Forum in Davos did the research, and they polled many employers, and they tried to figure out what are those flexible sciences, soft sciences, what are they? And because usually the employers, they always quote them when they start looking for new specialists. And I think that if there is a narrow specialization, it's not that important. Creative thinking, that's what is important, because they need to develop new products, they need to think outside the box, new competitive advantages need to be attained, and critical thinking needs to be there, and the emotional intellect, so then the ability to interact with people, so then the ability to work with people, make decisions, teamwork, and that's exactly, that is why today liberal arts is not only knowledge per se, so a new knowledge that appearing in new spheres and the knowledge of traditional sciences, but liberal arts is creating, forming a flexible skills, the ability to learn all the time, to be always on the go, to generate new ideas, new products, new meanings, new. So at our Department of Liberal Arts and Sciences of St. Petersburg University. So these are the main principles that we live by. And that makes us different from the classical education. Individual customized education, because we kind of abandon ourselves from the system where when I studied at St. Petersburg College, when we had different tracks, and all the three tracks actually would get the same number of hours of learning, and so we're the same, just as if we were just raised in an incubator, and so now just it's individual trajectory, customized trajectory. So each student has its unique type of learning during the 4 years of his study at the college, and they are all different. So that's what we call it, customization of education. But this approach motivates the student. The student becomes more interested and grasps new knowledge with greater alacrity, and because his involvement, her involvement, is much higher in this process. And what's important, that specialization after majoring, after the second course, we can always say that is quite challenging after the when you're only 17, and when you just left school, to identify your life for the rest of your life. You know how recently I was listening to an interview of Vladimir Posner, who was saying how many spheres of activities he had changed before he found his vocation, his life vocation, from biology all the way down to translation, interpretation, and other challenging areas. two years is given to the students, are given to the students to learn more, to see the general picture of the world, to play with different areas, and to try the hand. And the same as our students in liberal arts, so sometimes they switch from liberal to exact, from exact to liberal science. And so then these 2 years, they are given to make this choice. So then the next specifics is interdisciplinary approach. Because any object in the world needs to be studied comprehensively from different angles, from different sides, even at our department, so learning the brain, studying the brain, by linguists, by biologists, they study the brain, doctors, so different specializations in the comprehensive manner. Then the next specifics of our education is interactive pedagogical technologies. The students should be always involved. And that's why we have this predominance of discussions, papers, essays. So almost at every class, so the student has to speak. And that's why the teams are very small, so the groups are only 10 students, no more than that. And we don't have any lecturing, practically none, because the student independently should prepare for the next, having read the textbooks and the papers and the articles and everything, and should be able just to be involved in the discussions and being able to argue his position and speak up during the class, and certainly to protect the position on every almost every student participates in that. It's not like it was in our times when you could copy the lecture, study the textbook by the end of the quarter, and then take exam, to sit for an exam successfully. You have to work every time in every class, and so on. Up to 60 pages of special text every day, and you cannot catch up, and so then you cannot possibly catch up and then pass the exams if you don't work during the course. And then education is provided in two specialities, two disciplines. So liberal arts department, you just get the main discipline, whether special, do major, and then you major in something additional, so major and minor. So first major and then you minor. So you specialize yourselves in two types of knowledge, and that's on exact and humanities. It could be sometimes adjacent sciences, and that will help. Makes you more competitive and more sustainable. And if this form of education is so interesting, modern, captivating, then how well developed it is in the world right now? Has it become the model of the 21st century education, or not yet? So, and we need to answer this question, yes, because the majority of the United States colleges have already switched over to this model. United States, so this model has been around for decades. And so why this MIT University, Harvard, Princeton, Stanford, that are in the top global ratings. So they work along these lines. And so this model now is moving to Europe. And so then, so for 20, 30 years, so they are just doing the undergraduate component using this model, including Oxford University. So then in the last 10 years, Asia is moving over to this model. So for example, China, so six universities have switched over to this new model, including the Peking, Beijing University, six universities in Japan. So they go along these lines. And what about Russia? To what extent we can work within this new system? I'm talking about my department, the Department of Liberal Arts and Science of St. Petersburg State University. It's a program. It's a kind of interdepartmental program, so it was designed in 1999 jointly with the American Bard College, famous for its innovative approaches to education, and so they helped to introduce in St. Petersburg so this new system of liberal arts. To support this program, Mr. Lihachev wrote a letter to support this program and submitted it to the Ministry of Education. And they got this support. And this model has been in existence since that time. And by today, so it's been around for more than 20 years, and we can compare ourselves with other colleges of the world. And since 2020, so we started the Department of Liberal Arts within our college, and I'm the dean, and this year, so we'll be celebrating the 10th, will be marking the 10th anniversary of creation liberal arts department. Recently, there was a very interesting case when a student of our department, there was a discussion in a serious scientific center, so then that was a question. So I'm a student of the second course of St. Petersburg State University, so the liberal arts and science. Okay. So who is your dean? Mr. Kudrin. Question? Kudrin. Ah, Kudrin. Okay. Okay. Kudrin. So what does he understand in liberal arts? So that is good. He's friends with Mr. Gergiev, right? Maestro Gergiev. No, I'm joking. So, Mr. Kudrin understands everything. He is a professional in all sciences and all arts. You see, and it's not just an accustomed thing to have this model. So then liberal arts that has already proven its value all over the world, and which gives you a new opportunities and new opportunities for our students. And our students, I have to admit, so they're quite successful. And we have a unique diploma. So each diploma is an individual research, customized work. It's a piece of art. Certainly, maybe it's even different from what is done at our colleges, at other colleges, because it's kind of the intersection of other sciences. For example, so the study of geomagnetic storms and how they affect the stock exchange markets, or jazz in the art of Brodsky, or modeling the dynamics of the pandemic, and depending on the characteristics of the operations of international airports on the basis of multi-gender approach. That's why inside one department, so then there's specialization of exact and humanities. So it's kind of a cognitive, comprehensive study. So then, for example, there's another area, is a complex system of science of the world and society. And so it's one, then the analysis of big data, for example, working with the big data. So then anyone, any student of the department can make use of it. So they want this, they can major in their traditional sphere, for example, so the criticism of the movies, theater, science, architecture, economists, sociologists, but they can combine the achievements of different sciences and make the best of all the sciences. And our main pride of our faculty, for example, this year, so then the government award so was given to Mr. Gershenzon, because he was studying a certain play, ballet, and so he on the basis of the previous study of all the ballets, he developed a new play and a new ballet. And so then the Gold Mask Award was given to one of our teachers for the opera that he that he made, this called prose. And it became not only just very popular in St. Petersburg, the world of linguistics was prepared by famous, renowned Mrs. Chernigovskaya, who heads the department and the lab of brain study, and got the global world recognition on a very important platform, Coursera. She got the first place among other courses of the kind by the results of 2020. And that's why we have lots of achievements. We have more awards given. And so the creative potential of our department now serves the interests of our students, but not only at our department. So these attempts to create this model are so important, because I want to point out one very important thing, that RANEPA that set up this department a few years ago. They have this department. Maybe it's not. It does not yet fully have all these principles that I spoke about. But so the approach is somewhat different. But still, by and large, it works as the model, liberal arts model, generally very similar. So then the Tumen University School of Prospective Studies, that they work within the realm of liberal arts and sciences as well. And that is why, so in the near future, so there will be the first graduation of not enough. It's just very small. It's not sufficient. We need to scale it up in order to be competitive in this world.
But
naturally, we have challenges. What we can see, so then this movement of this model of education goes across, against the current, because people's minds are set, and it's based mostly on the enthusiasm and motivation of the deans and the faculty of these colleges. So that's to switch over this model. That could be just on the experimental basis, a trial balloon. Let it be only for those colleges, universities that are ready to welcome this new approaches to education. Because we need to it's much more difficult just to work to customize every student rather than just to teach them all together. And so we need to new system of regulation of the way the students are taught. So we need to introduce this new state education standard, because we're doing exact sciences, humanities. And when these two components get together, when exacts and humanities get together, that's where we get the synergy. So we need just to overcome the boundaries, the limitations, constraints of different departments. We need to go further, and so we can talk about it. And so there are many hurdles to clear. And I think that so that's why getting full support right now, the Ministry of Education, in order to go along this way. And so recently I was talking about this model after this serious in the serious meeting with Mr. with our President Putin, and so he supported the idea just to build to add another program on the basis of the liberal arts for other universities, because we have a course. So he supported that idea. So then we already have this course of advanced studies of interactive studies for the teachers of other colleges and universities, and I'm talking about this liberal model of education. It is true that we certainly want our education to be competitive. It's not the only form; it's the only set of principles that are being implemented as welcoming the new challenges of the world. And so, when I was a deputy mayor of St. Petersburg, and I worked in that capacity, there were instances when people came to me. This is a different spheres, different people, different specialties, different disciplines, and they would come to me and would ask me to organize meetings, sports events, support teams. They would come to me with requests for different kinds of support, so the private support, other types of support, and so very important things for the city and for the country. But then, at certain point, I made a choice. The most important thing for our country is developing education, is evolving in this area, because I made a decision that I'm not going just to support education, and so I've been involved in educational programs of universities. Sometimes they're private, small universities that they are trying their hand, experiment, but the results are excellent. And I would like, in conclusion of my presentation, I'd like to go back to the words I started with. I think that the modern system of education must teach us to think. So let's learn to think. And certainly it should contribute to development of our culture, of our country, and the principles of education and the state management. Without this, we wouldn't succeed.